preachers and all of the other guests that are here, I just want to express, and I'm a little emotional. Is that okay? You all have treated us royally. Such hospitality. And I'm going to tell you, I feel exactly at home. Praise the Lord. And I'm also stirred in the inner man by the power of the Holy Spirit. So thankful. Could we just stand, if you can? And I'd like for us to, first of all, have prayer and thank God for the ministry here in Summitville, Indiana. I've never been here. I've never heard of the place. I've had a few people that I've told were going to Summitville and seriously said, where? And then I explained a little more. Does anybody have sense what I said?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, with gratitude in our hearts tonight, from the depths of our innermost being, we thank you, dear Lord, for what has been happening, not just our arrival as a ministerial association, but what's been going on right here with your direction and your guidance and the leadership of this congregation. Lord, we're believing and continuing to look to you to hear reports of growth and spiritual growth within the local church and this community. And again, Lord, we thank you for the hospitality that we have just enjoyed so much, the love of the brethren and sisters that are here. Our lives have been enhanced because of what you have put together in Summitville, Indiana. Thank you for this day and now for this privilege that we have to worship together for the ministry of the quartet. Lord, we're looking forward to everything that's said and done tonight. We commit this service, Lord, our time and our hearts, divinely into your hands. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Can everybody say amen?
Amen.
Shake hands with somebody as you're being seated. If you don't happen to know, introduce yourself. Amen. This is a friendly church. Well, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Can we give God praise, a great loud land clap?
My knees in the night, and I prayed to the Lord in the sight.
for.
Close and yet so far. Oh, I need another chance. seems to get the best of me. But as long as you are there, I know that I will make it every step along the way. Please hear my prayer. A heart like yours is my desire. A heart like yours is what I'm searching for. Full of compassion, nothing wrong with you. Please hear me, Lord, give me a heart like yours. So much grace, so much kindness.
Others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who from being in the form of God, thought it was not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men, and being found in the fashion of man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, of things in earth, and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to do to do will and to do his good pleasure. Do all things without murmurs and disputes, that you may be blameless and harmless in the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom he shines as light in the world. Let's pray. Lord, I ask that you help me tonight. Lord, help me, hide me behind your cross. Anoint me to speak your word. Lord, where I am weak, strengthen me tonight, Jesus. Help us to hear what you're speaking to the church. And may you receive all the glory and honor. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The theme that Pastor Bean has chosen for this conference, the theme of generosity, I believe is a timely one. When we try to teach on a topic, I always try to go back, and I feel it's necessary to go back to the foundation. After all, Psalms chapter 11, verse 3 says, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundation is destroyed, it says, what can you and I do? We must first go back and look at the foundation. Come on, somebody. The church in America must turn quickly and examine our foundation. We must see what is wrong with the foundation. The foundation of the church as a whole has systematically been chipped away for decades. And now we want to blame the next generation for what the church has currently become. No, my friend, it's all of our faults. It's all of our faults. You've heard it before. You can throw a frog into a pot of boiling water and it'll jump out. But if you put the frog in a cool pot and slowly turn up the heat, it will stay in there till it boils. Can I tell you that's what's happened to the church? Those that are older will remember a time when the church used to be generous. The people in America used to be generous. But over time, the foundations of the church, the foundations of our country has been destroyed. It's time for you and I to stand up and repair the breach. It's time for the repairers of the breach to rise up and take charge and repair the foundations on which our church, our community, and our nation was built. So when I think about the foundation, I was led to the following two questions. Why does generosity seem to be lacking in today's world? And number two, how do we rekindle a flame of generosity in our hearts? When I watch the news today and I see the condition of the world we live in, one thing I fail to see, for the most part, is any resemblance of generosity. And I believe the reason for that is very simple. See, generosity is one of the many characteristics of God. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. God gave his son because he's generous.
Amen.
But you can only have a generous heart if you love. John 3:16 tells us that God gave because he's generous, and he's generous because he loves. But according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2, the devil is the prince of the power of the air, the temporary ruler of this world. Thus it stands to reason that this world would be diametrically opposed to anything resembling love and generosity. Love as defined as the world is not, the world defines it, is not love as God defines it. It's different. We live in a society where we're taught to watch our backs. In the world of business, we're taught to make it to the top by any means, even if it means stepping on or double-crossing your co-workers. We wonder why there's so much corruption in the corporate world. We look at the political arena, we go into the voting booths, and we scratch our head. We don't know which party to vote for anymore. Both sides are drunken with power. We look at politicians and wonder, is this the best and brightest that our country has to offer to lead us into our future? All the while, backroom bribes and deals rule the day. We sit in our living rooms behind locked doors and we watch tragedy after tragedy unfold on the evening news. Then on Sundays, people across the nation will go into houses of worship. But can love be found there? Can generosity be found there? Church, we need help. Turn to the person next to you tonight and say, we need help. The church in America needs help. So going back to question number one, why does generosity seem to be lacking in today's world? I believe the answer is very simple. The church as a whole no longer has a heart like God's heart. Our heart no longer breaks for the things that break His heart. Our heart no longer rejoices for the things that make God's heart rejoice. Max Lucado once asked this question. He said, what if for one day Jesus were to become you? What if for 24 hours Jesus wakes up in your bed, walks in your shoes, lives in your house, assumes your schedule? Your heart gets the day off, and your life is led by the heart of Christ. His priorities govern your actions. His passions drive your direction. His love directs your behavior. He goes on to ask, what would it be like? Would people notice a change? Your family, would they see something new? Your coworkers, would they sense something different? What about the less fortunate? Would you treat them the same? And your friends, would they detect more joy? How about your enemies? Would they receive more mercy coming from Christ's heart working within you? Then Max Lucado makes it personal. He asks, and you, how would you feel? Would this alter your mood? This heart transplant, would it affect your temper? Would you look at situations differently? Would you respond to those situations in a different way? Would you still dread what you're dreading? Better yet, would you still do what you're doing? It's a sobering thought. Yet in the context for the theme of this conference, I believe it's a thought we desperately should consider. This brings me to question number two. How do we rekindle the flame of generosity in our hearts? I want to circle back to what Paul is saying in our opening text, Philippians chapter 2. Because what Paul is describing, what he is telling the church here in Philippi, it's to have the heart of God. Simply enough, have the heart of God. Verse 2 says, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind, letting nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowness of mind. Let each esteem the other better than themselves. That's generosity. Look not to every man on his own things, but every man on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Or could I say it like this? Let this heart be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Verse 6, being in the form of God, thought it was not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant. And he was made in the likeness of man, and being found in the fashion of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even the death of the cross. Jumping down to verse 12, wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Paul is saying, take everything into what I just said into account. Take everything that I said and work out your salvation very fearfully. Verse 13, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. How is 13 possible? It's possible when we have the heart of God. Verse 14 says, do all things without murmurs and disputes. That would disqualify half of the church in America today. There you go. Hello. That ye be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. God's true desire,
oh, yes.
His true desire, for you and me in his church is nothing short of a heart transplant. Of a heart transplant. We need to stress this, ministers, in our congregation. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 23 and 24 tells us, and being renewed in the spirit of your mind, that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 goes even further. It says, wherefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature.
Amen.
Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Listen, it's one thing to know the mind, to know the heart of God. We can all pretty well know what God's characteristics are, but to have his heart, to possess his qualities, that's what he wants for us. See, we were all born with the old sin nature, which is greedy and it's unloving. But when we're born again, the old sin nature should die. And we should begin a new life with a new heart. But not only do we need to receive new hearts when we're born again, but we need to fashion that heart after God's heart. And that can only come with intimacy with Christ. That's another problem in the modern church today. We've not spent enough time with God. We don't know his qualities. Can I tell you, the longer that I live with my wife, the more I know her qualities, the more I know her thoughts, the more I know what direction she's going to take. That only comes with spending time with her. But in this modern church, we're satisfied coming in on Sunday mornings. And if you're still with the old school, Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, three times a week, and we leave it there. We don't spend time with God anymore. And how can we fashion our heart after God's heart when we don't know his heart? Yes, we know his qualities and generalities, but do we know him? Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 says, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, be made conformed unto his death.
That's it.
Do we really know the Lord as we should? Do we really know the heart of the Lord? The heart of love. The heart of generosity. Caring and compassionate. It should be our desire that we make progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding his wonders more strongly and more clear day after day. That's what he wants for you. That I may know him in the same way of his suffering. To come to know the outflow of love from his heart. And in doing so, I can turn around and share that love, that generosity with a dying world. Pastors and church leaders, it's imperative that we teach our congregations exactly what the heart of God looks like. And we teach them how to foster an intimate relationship with God. We teach them how to host the presence of God in their daily life, to where their life is no longer an occasional visitation, but a constant habitation of the glory of God.
That's an habitation.
If a person has the heart of God, generosity will come natural to that person. It will be instantaneous with that person. I know it's basic. I saw a fellow minister on Facebook said the other day, he said, the more I look for something in Scripture that no one has ever seen, the more I find something that's not there. So sometimes we need to get back to the basics. We need to get back to the foundation. You know, things like Matthew chapter 9, beginning at verse 39, where it says, "But I say unto you that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, turn to him the other. And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. Give to him that asks thee, and from him that would borrow of thee, turn not away." That's generosity. That's love. Verse 43, you heard it said, "Thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. But this I say unto you, love your enemies and bless them that curse you. Do good unto them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." That's love and generosity. "That ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and send rain on the just and on the unjust. For if ye love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do you salute more than others? Do not even the publicans do so? Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect." Everything in that passage runs in stark contrast to human nature. Most people find it hard to love the people they like, let alone their enemy.
Hello.
You know what I see in that passage? I see ultimate love.
Yes, sir.
Ultimate generosity. In today's terms, we define the word charity as giving to someone in need or giving to an organization that helps people in need. We define that as charity. But the word charity in the New Testament is a Greek word, agape. Agape is translated 27 times as charity. One time as dear, and 86 times as love. You see, what God intends is for generosity and love to be the same. He intends them to be the same. Even to the extent where he uses the same word to describe them. Can I tell you, if we want our churches to be generous, we need a revival of agape. We need a revival of love. You know, as Pastor Phil was saying today, we're not going to reach certain people if we don't show love.
Amen.
If we don't welcome them in as they are in the church. Now, that doesn't mean we condone where they are in their sin, but we love them. And we preach the word. We do not, under any circumstances, water down the word.
Amen.
We do not. But if we welcome people in and we love them and we stand behind the sacred desk and we preach Jesus Christ to them, a change will happen. I believe a change will happen. We need love. John 15, verses beginning at verse 9, it says, "As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you." He stops there, doesn't he? No, no, no. He says, "Continue in my love." How did Jesus love you?
He gave his life.
He gave his life and he loved you just the way you were. You didn't have to change anything. There was nothing we could do to make him love us more. Verse 10, it says, "If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy might be fulfilled. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends." You know, come to think of it, maybe this is why there's not much joy in the church anymore. Because this verse, where it says, "May my joy be fulfilled in you," is directly connected to love. The church needs a fresh desire for God's love and generosity. Why? Because it's the one thing the world is lacking. You see, the world is good at being rough and tough. It's good at being ruthless and cold and uncompassionate. This world is filled with fear and hate. Why? Because the devil does it so well. That's his job. But what's missing is true love and generosity. Now more than ever, the church has the opportunity. We have the opportunity to show the world what Jesus was really like through his love and generosity. Why? Because God's word commands it. He commands it. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 27 says, "He giveth unto the poor. He that giveth to the poor shall not lack. But he that hides his eyes shall have many a curse." We find in the New Testament the same mandate in 1 John chapter 3, verse 17. But whosoever hath in this world's goods, and seeth his brother having need, and shut up his bowels of compassion for him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? Amen. But Pastor Josh, why is this so important? It's important because it's the heart of God. We are God's hands extended, reaching out to a world that is lost. We all can, and we all must, show the love of God through generosity. God is counting on us. But Pastor Josh, I don't have much. It makes no difference. Little is much when God is in it. This has already been referred to this morning in one of the sessions in Mark chapter 12, verse 42. It says, "There came a certain poor widow, and she threw in two mites, which maketh a farthing. And he called upon his disciples and said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that this poor widow has cast in more than all that they have casted in the treasury. For all they did was cast out of their abundance, but she of her want did she cast all that she had, even all of her living." This widow didn't have much, but she gave it all. Can I tell you, when I get to heaven, I want to see what happened to her. Because I believe blessing came upon that life. This touched the heart of the Lord so much that we're still talking about it to this day. This widow woman, the people that have in her day would have cast her aside. We're not talking about them. We're talking about her. Because it touched the heart of God. Amen. That right there is his heart. I want to close tonight with this last passage. It's found in Matthew chapter 25, beginning at verse 31. It says, "When the Son of Man shall come in all his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory." Aren't you looking forward to it? Oh, when I think of that, when I get that picture in my mind, it gives me chills. When he's sitting on his throne with all of his glory. "And before him," verse 32, "and before him shall be gathered all nations. And he shall separate them one from another. And as a shepherd divided his sheep from goats, and he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Then shall the king say unto them on his right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For when I was hungry, you gave me meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came unto me. Then shall the righteous answer him, saying, the Lord, when saw we thee hunger and fed thee, or thirsty and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger and took thee in, or naked and clothed thee? Or when did we see thee sick or in prison and come unto you? And the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as you have done to the least of these, my brethren, you have done it to me.
Amen.
I want you to take note, he didn't say, you had massive crusades. He didn't say, you healed the masses. He said, you were generous to me. You were generous. You showed me love. You showed me love. Stand with me tonight, please. The foundation. The foundation of love and generosity. I believe these are the keys that can unlock the door to the hearts of men in our communities. If we can repair the foundation, I believe we can reach people that are unreachable. I believe that. I truly believe that if we repair the foundation through intimacy with God and learning His heart, and asking God to place His heart in us, asking Him that He would break our heart for what breaks His, that our heart would rejoice for the things that make His heart rejoice. That's the key. That's the key. Someone's life is counting on it. They are waiting on you and I to show them love and to show them generosity. Can I ask you tonight to take the hand of the person next to you? And I want you just to spend the next few moments just pray for the person on your right. Pray for the person on your left. Ask them that more than ever before that God will show them His heart. Come on, do that right now. Oh God, help us tonight. Help your church across this nation. Lord, show us your heart. Lord, let us have a fresh vision of you, of your love and your generosity. Lord, you gave, you loved, and you gave. And we are your hands on earth, Lord. Help us to love and give as you loved and give. We ask you, Lord, in the hearts of your people across the nation, to do heart transplants, oh God. Transplant our old nasty heart that's corrupted with your precious heart, Jesus. Lord, take us behind the veil and show us. Show us, Lord, your secret things. Show us, Lord, the intimate side of your nature. Give us a glimpse, a fresh vision of you, O God. Lord, I truly believe as we draw closer to you, I truly believe that love and generosity will be generated in our heart. Lord, I pray for the pastors in this church. I pray for their congregations. God, let a revival of love, let a revival of generosity be birthed. Let a hunger for your spirit, for your presence, for your anointing be present in their congregations. Lord, help us through your love and generosity, transform our community. Because it's needed, oh God. People are in need of you. Lord, not that we would receive glory. Lord, we're simply your hands extended. Lord, that you would receive, that the name of Jesus would forever be lifted high. The banner, the agape banner of your name, the banner of Jesus, would be lifted high across our congregations. That people would come in and feel the love and feel the generosity. Lord, we ask it in your name. Grant it, Jesus. Grant it, Lord. And we will forever give you the glory. We will forever give you praise. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Somebody say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's give him praise tonight.